I think James is going to try and build something of substance for you to see how he works. So without further ado, over to James.
Thanks for coming. I think you had two people to almost more nerve-wracking too. I mean, normally when I'm working, I don't know if you've seen some of the pieces on display, it was a really good piece. And when I'm slab building, I'm not trying to attempt to work with really big, tall slabs straight away. It's half the battle there is making sure that piece isn't collapsing, and it's quite hard to sort of control and shape, I suppose. So I work with, I make big slabs of clay, got a really big slab roller, quite a few years. When I was starting out, I just used to use a wooden rolling pin. Half a day to prepare enough substantial sheets of clay to make one piece. I finally managed to get some funding from the Arts Council, and I spent half of the budget on this fancy machine from America, which is a slab roller. If you've never heard of them, it's a bit like a posh mangle. So it's two rollers, you can put a block of paper inside and roll it through. So that sort of sped up, I suppose, the preparation time, and it means that I'm getting clay slabs of an even thickness, and you can vary that thickness as well. So a big 4.5 foot, 5 foot piece, which is the limit, I can't go any bigger than that at the moment. I work with quite chunky clay, quite a bit, probably twice the thickness of the clay that you see here. All my vessels, whether it's a baby piece or a big piece, the clay will always start off quite a lot thicker than I find it wants. So that I've got room once I've built the structure to carve away at it and scrape away at it, which is, I suppose that's the bit that I really enjoy. Sometimes I find the making process quite sort of stressful and tense. And I think when Alex came to the studio, it wasn't the tidiest of places, and it's a bit sort of haphazard, I suppose. I'll just explain as well what these are. I trained at the Royal College of Art, did my MA there after my Loughborough degree. And when I was there, the tutors at the time really sort of interrogated me and ripped me apart at the beginning. I went there very cocky and confident, I got first for my degree, felt that I had lots of development potential with the pieces that I were making at the time, which again were big monumental pieces. And Martin Smith, the professor of the course, turned around and said, "No, you're not doing that, you need to leave that behind, you need to start with something new. What's your passion, what do you like about clay?" And I gave a very sort of feeble reply and said, "I like making pots." Okay. What do you like making? Why do you like making pots? What do you like about them? And I think at the time I struggled to sort of explain myself and bring myself across. And he said, "Well, could you contain emotions in vessels? How could you go about containing different sort of themes in your work?" And I thought, "What on earth is he on about?" So they sent me away, and I had like 2 weeks of preparation and development and experimentation. But I had to fill the seminar room with all these models and the kits in either plaster, cardboard, whatever it looks like, and made all these weird things. Spent the first week panicking, thinking I was in the wrong place, and I wanted to leave and go home. And sat down with one of the tutors who were really helpful at the time and said, "Well, look, just go for it. Have a good play, have fun with it." So my first year at the Royal College was very, very experimental, which was something that I've not done for a while. You spent your degree honing your skills and developing a certain body and style of work, and then suddenly to have all this freedom to just play was a bit daunting, really. I ended up on my MA making these huge sculptural seats. They were big sculptural forms, and we made a big plaster mould of a giant exercise ball. So myself and the plaster technician, we made this big 8-piece cast of an inflatable ball, a really big one. And so this is sort of what I've got here. All these sections of mould were moved away from the seating. I wanted to get back into vessel forms, sculptural forms, and I had all these big curved plaster sections in my studio, and slab building is something I've always been passionate about from my introduction to clay on foundation course. And so I started to play around rolling sheets of clay out and laying them into the moulds, and started to build an experiment. So I suppose the work that I'm making now has been developing sort of steadily over the last 8 to 10 years, really. So the plaster formers, all they're there for is to basically enable me to form the slabs into curves. And I made these last night in the studio's cold studio, even in the summer, I think it warms up. But in winter, I got to work in long johns and bad clay. We suffer for our art. So the clay can sometimes, in winter, take a few days to become leather hard. And I'll just try and see if I can lift this up. So I made that last night, and it's holding its shape quite well, and it's still very pliable and flexible, and you can cut into it and build with it. I use Valentine's clays, brilliant clays, and this is their light professional clay, it's the Ashraf Hanna clay that I've been using for a while. And I also use the black clay as well, which is messy to work with, you can get some quite interesting colours and so on. So what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to chop this in half. Work small to begin with. Then watch what I'm doing. It's a plastic sheet down here and these are flying. So for the single vessel forms, or most of the vessel forms, I start with a former and I work from that and build my way up. I don't have a set idea in my head. I just go with flow and it grows as I work. I don't have any templates, there's no drawings to work from. But actually recently I have started to do some big charcoal drawings just to sort of try some things out. So to begin with, all I'm going to do is make sure that the slab's pretty smooth in the mould and it's nicely compressed in there. And just using a knife or a needle, I will start to sketch, and I'll hold this up in a minute if you can't see what I'm doing. Start to sketch a series of lines into the clay. If I don't like what I've done, I'll just use a scraper tool and rub it out. When I start building, I won't stick rigidly to these lines, it's just giving me a little bit of a guide. So I'll hold that up. You get it dropping out. Can you all see that? So very simple lines. And over time as well, when I'm cutting into the space, when I've finished the piece and I'm cutting and trimming the excess away, which I probably won't get around to today. I'll lift this out so you can see. I'll just put that there for now. Something that my wife's an abstract painter, and she loves the actual marks and the lines that have occurred over time when I've been cutting.
You never get bits in the clay from the plaster.
Well, that's a bit of a grey area, isn't it? Using plaster and clay together. Yeah. You've got to be really, really careful. So I make sure my moulds are nice and smooth, nice and clean before I start working with them. So much scraping when we find afterwards that it takes all the bits away. But there's something interesting in those marks and surfaces in the moulds that I'm starting to incorporate quite loosely into the form as well, and with the drawings that I do. And the good thing about these moulds as well is that I can make lots. I've got 10 of these in my studio, so I can rapidly get lots of slabs made for a piece. So if it's a big commission, a big 5-foot-tall piece, you don't want to keep having to stop and start and make slabs. I try and get them all made in one session so that I've got enough of the right consistency to work with.
What do you use for the mould?
I use an exercise ball to cast from, and then this is just plaster of Paris, which is technically, it's quite hard to make a cast of an inflatable ball. You have to, I put it on a bucket so it's not going to roll around everywhere, and then build up a clay. Well, in fact, actually what I do is roll the slab out, drape that over the ball, use a damp sponge and really get it nice and suctioned onto the ball, and then build up a clay wall barrier around that.
And the first layer, the
yeah, and the first layer of plaster, I apply like sort of milk consistency or single cream, and just do a very thin layer on that first of all. Mix up another batch, so it becomes like soft cheese consistency, and then smear that on so it's a bit like a pavlova. I love working with plaster; it's fantastic. And yeah, I like the moulds as well. So to begin with, I'm going to start quite low down, and I'll probably have to just keep sort of flipping it up so you can see what I'm doing. I'm just going to chop this into a shorter, more manageable strip. I left these in the van this morning. I was panicking to go back to the van because it was really hot in there. Put the slab straight out. So that's going to sit like that. And I'm always conscious of the direction of it and where it's going to go. And at the moment, that slab is coming in too much straight away. And I don't want it to do that. I want it to sort of curve out first of all. So I use like little sort of strips, little scraps of clay. Big waste as well. Lots of scrap in the studio, lots of bins full of reclay, which at some point I need to sort out. So what I'm actually going to do now is I'm going to tilt this slab way. You just put a prop there, put a prop there. So, if you can see it, it's just leaning back a bit more now, which means that it will gradually curve over rather than be too severe straight away. And I suppose I use my knife and scribe along, sort of like a furniture maker would do when they're scribing a worktop into a kitchen or something, following the line of the wall. And it's really critical that the joins are spot on and they're going to really meet up together well. But the base section, probably what I tend to do it then, but what I tend to do is once I build the base section, I will lift the whole thing out, turn it upside down, and then use a paddler and beat around it to make sure they're really well butted together. Pieces, but I mean, I really am. When I'm working on a piece, I've got no plan at all. They just grow. Sometimes they look a dog's dinner, and sometimes they work straight away. And often it's the ones that look a dog's dinner that have to do lots of sort of that end up being stronger pieces. So I'm just going now. I've got an evening class student. It's actually really handy because she likes making little slab build sculptural forms, so each week I donate her another piece. She's really excited. It's fantastic play.
I'm just going to snap it into two of it.
You can really bend it round and it'll be quite forgiving. The black clay I tend to find is a little bit shorter, so a little less forgiving, but sometimes mix this clay into it, which is
Do you use a grub one with the black clay? Do you use a grub one?
It's very groggy. That's still very groggy, but you can get some interesting texture when you start carving.
It's just not as easy to work
with.
It dries sometimes.
Yeah. So I tend to work with a black clay when it's actually very soft, and work with lower strips. And so the brown pieces that are on display are a mixture made using the two. So I'm relatively happy with where that one's going to sit, and it's sitting quite flush. So what I'll do then is lift that away, and what I usually do is get a few in place first, and then start to lift them away and do the glue. I don't use slip. I haven't used slip for a long time. I sort of think, well, if you score the surface of a slab and then you apply the slip over the top, you're smoothing out the cross hatching. So what I do is I just use some water and a brush and wet the surface quite a lot. And then use a fork or an onion cutter, I've discovered, which is just this little thing with lots of metal spikes, which is really quick. And I use my garden, when I make the big garden seeds, I was there with butters knife. It's taking like an hour to score one little bit. Hold this up for a second. So I quite heavily score that surface. And then the same on this bit. Sometimes if I think that joins a little bit uneven, I can run one of these little mini surfboard blades along it and just get that nice and even if it's not quite. Right, it's a little bit lumpy and bumpy. Where's that hole? Because we have so there. There's a hole in the floor. Right, so and sometimes I'll go back over it again, wet it, cross hatch it a bit again. The main thing is making sure your lines are going down, you know where that slab's going to go. So once it's roughly in place, I'll sandwich the clay with the palms of my hands and just gently sort of slide it and compress it down the flex without pinching the clay and making the clay too thin. and stuff can work quite quick. They tend to work really, really slow. I'm always using tools as well. So when the slab's in place, I'll use this, which I've had this for a long time. It was a student that was with me at Loughborough University, and she was making little sort of slab built, little sort of cityscapes. And I was always nicking this from her. And then at the end of the course, she was not going to do ceramics anymore, I was going to law college, so she gift-wrapped it again. And I've later discovered it's actually a chopped down children's cricket bat. No, I knew that until recently. Quite firmly packed it like that, and that will help to compress it in place. I'm not going to do this today, but I would, when I've put a few in place, I'll go back in there, score and cross-hatch all the way around the inside of the base, up the edges, and then work soft clay coils into those to help to tie all together. And you can see it's great clay, really. You can really twist it right around at the right consistency, and it will hold that shape without splitting. You know what? I'm going to totally ignore those lines that I've done. I'll just do something a bit weird. And recent pieces as well are becoming a bit more architectural, with lots more sort of sections and facets to them. So I don't know, something quite interesting about that slab really curling between now and inside. I think when I start really massively increasing the scale, like I am going to do soon, it'll be interesting to make some huge things, and we've actually got these little sort of corridors, I suppose, and bits that you can't quite see yet. So I'm just going to wing it. When I'm trimming the slabs down, I always do it fairly rough to begin with, leave a little bit there, a little bit of an overlap. And then chop it on the inside. I always find as well, for a few years doing exhibitions, people come up to me and say, oh, I love your work, but it's just too big. I've got nowhere to put it. So I start to make some little pieces. And I exhibited these little pieces at Ceramic Art London nobody batted an eye with it, and the bigger stuff that I got purchased. And actually making the little pieces very fiddly, you can't get the hand inside. So I much prefer working on this scale. You can really get stuck into the physicality of it. I quite like that one there. And once you've bent the clay and formed it, it will hold up quite well.
What sort of condition is the clay when you're doing that?
I keep it at this condition, so until I build the piece, I'll keep it sprayed, keep it wrapped up. If it's a really big piece, the bit that I'm happy with will be wrapped up in cling film, and the bit that I'm working on is open, uncovered. And even when I'm loading them into the kiln, the bigger pieces, I'll load them into the kiln when they're just past leather hard, so that at least if I've knocked it or damaged it, I can take it back out and repair it. And that's just now I'm in a group studio called the Sculptural actually, it's a really great setup, really inspiring. Lots of artists there, so you can feed off each other, I suppose, but the other thing is when you get ready for a show like this, I managed to load everybody else into helping me load the van, but also helping to load things in the kiln. One of the guys that's there, a guy called Brendan Esmond-Dalsh, ex-big animal sculptures, and we're both sort of working together at the moment on some larger scale pieces in a hybrid works. In fact, there's another exhibition coming in October, the Art Market in York at the Racecourse. Myself and Brendan are going to be there in a bit of a clay war, making big stuff on stage. If I talk as much as I'm doing now, I'm not really looking forward to it. this section and this section in place and show you how I start to build up them.
I'm reminded of a very contrasting method of slab building by what is called Henry Penn. In his early work, he would make and build these complex forms in cardboard and a pair of scissors. So he got what he wanted and untaped. Untaped them all and used pieces rather like a dressmaker's pattern to put the clay back. But that was a much more premeditated design approach. It's really intriguing seeing this improvisational approach with slab.
I don't know whether using templates would help or not, really. It would probably mean less wastage, sort of, I suppose. But this slab here, I want this to fit into that space. At the moment, it's a bit too straight, so I've got the curve there this way, but I can actually now start to bend it that way as well. Do some really bizarre random things in the studio, a bit like people on a bobsleigh when they're imagining this, they run on the way down and they sort of they do this, don't they? And I do that when I'm working. People walk past my studio and see me doing this in midair. The initial stage, that's the critical bit really. Can't go any higher until I'm happy with this. And I will spend quite a bit of time faffing around, cutting bits away, adding bits. Sometimes I totally start from scratch if I'm really frustrated with it. At least starting from scratch at this stage is better than getting really high up and then wanting to scrap it. So when I'm happy with the shape and I've built it and I've spent some time on the inside getting this nice and neat, and that's another reason for working quite low down in levels like this, I can neaten up the inside as I go. So I'm not reaching right down inside at all, less or trying to tighten it up. So at this stage now what I'll do is I'll trim this down so it's all nice and level, ready for the next stack, I suppose. Even more clay. I mean Valentine's is really doing a recycling service and rebook it for me. To get this nice and level, I would use a big flat surf or work around that to get really precise and level, and for now I'll just use this. So the next stage, to get this to sit on there perfectly, I've got a little bit of tinkering to do. And you can see that's sort of leaning in quite a bit, and there's a bit of a change of direction there which I want to get rid of and avoid. So what I do.
Before you join your tongue, can you all see? Should we just tip it up the bottom part?
Yeah,
up,
sure.
Yeah. And we'd like to see what you've got so far. Ah, that's easier to see than the sand. What an intriguing shape. Yeah. And the potential for having another thin curving piece in the end that you've left over to the bottom.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And as well at this stage, if the slab's coming in too much, I can use a bit of sponge, damp sponge, and I can start to bellow and stretch the clay out. So just use my hand like that to stretch it. So to get this one to sit how I want it on there, I hold it. This is where sometimes I look a bit of a wall. The bigger slabs on, like stick my nose against it or my head to stop it from falling over.
To help hold it?
I think I'm alright, I'll just put my arm there. And then what I'm doing is I'm just running my knife without stabbing my arm along the surface of the slab that's, that I've just surformed and scribing along. I've just dropped my arm. Pull that away, and then that should sit fairly nicely in place. And I knew this is where things would go wrong. It's got that sort of change of direction, but that's probably quite interesting. All the feature of the changes in direction. I'll go over there. I'll leave it as that.
Transforms it so quickly.
Yeah. And I never really have an issue with things collapsing either. When I
when you're making in real time, do you make just one piece?
I can't, typical bloke, I can't multitask. I find it very difficult to have a few on the go. Like Brendan, when he's making his animal sculptures, he'll make the torso and leave that to one side, move on to something else, move on to something else. I can't do that. I have to see a piece through from start to finish, whether it's a little piece or a really big one.
So whilst you're continuing the build, I just want to pick up on something you said. So I had questions. Me too. Why is that? Some people love to work to commission, others don't. You ended up kind of saying, well, the advantages, but it's quite a bit in commissions.
I've done a fair few recently. One really, really exciting. I've been quite lucky in that people like the style. If they're ordering piece and it's a colour that is on display or whatever, I tend to just leave them alone and let them do it. I haven't had any disaster where I've turned up at somebody's house and hated it, luckily, so far. The other things I want to do, I can come closer to it.
Another aspect of James's work that intrigued you seeing it, probably is the intrigue as you explore the work, of how much it changes when you look around it. Some pieces almost appear to have a front and a back, because from one view, it's a very simple shape and not much undulation in it. But from another view, there's an awful lot of undulation. So looking around the piece was an intrigue. And you'll see this on the work on the stand. The other intrigue was the starkness of black and white. It's so powerfully in there.
Yeah.
And I think I asked you about whether you envisage that at this stage, because changes the perception of the piece, whether it's sure start black or start white.
Yeah, and I think the views ever in my mind a finished colour. It can change. It all depends on the exhibition you do, and the work you're making, what you already have with a certain colour or tone. Even like the black clay, by varying the temperature and kiln, it's quite interesting thing. And I suppose my firing methods are so boring. Turn the key on, program it off, it goes, and I was quite interested and fascinated with people like James Tate, who's next to me, or Matthew Blakely, the firing is a very physical process, isn't it? It's you're fueling that fire and building up the heat gently. The bits of man I get my friends at university, I love all that, I love that process. So it's always really nice getting that studio environment, either into an exhibition with spotlights or in somebody's home. It's always really nice when I actually get to hand deliver a piece and take it and see its final place. It's so varied from really traditional, sort of quite old fashioned buildings to more new.